make. At that time, of course, workers were under close supervision by managers, and they were relying on extrinsic motivators. They were relying in money. Actually, at that time, Henry Ford figured out that actually if they double the salaries, people are started to produce much more cars per day. So basically, they were really motivating by money or punished by other reasons if they would not perform. But today, world is completely different. So today, world is changing at every single day. Competition is tough. New companies are coming up every single day. The nature of work is completely different. People are completely different. So today, world, we are highly, highly skilled people in comparison with past. And there is no more the possibility of having centralized positions, centralized decisions. We need to empower people to actually take the decision on the daily basis in order to do the best for their customers, for their companies. Everyone knows nowadays that extrinsic motivators are not working anymore. We need to find other ways to motivate people. So this is how the society works. But still, today we are using these practices called performance appraisals that we're using since the beginning of the 20th century. But like I said, today the society is completely different. So let's see a bit what happens when actually you use the same ways of managing or kind of keep tracking of people are doing and establish goals when we live in a completely different society. So actually, this is the result of a survey that actually 90% of review system are not successful. 95% of HR professionals says they are super unsatisfied with this. Does not work, simply does not work. Now, guys, you are here, most of you work in companies. I ask you, if you have a company and you have a customer, or if you have a product that 95% of your customer says the product suck, would you actually continue doing this? Do you actually continue to do the product? I don't think so, right? So I wonder why we still use this process. As the answer is simple. Every time I talk with people, people always tell me, we need performance appraisals because otherwise people will not get feedback. People will not receive increases. And there is no way to help them if we don't have performance appraisals. People need them to get better. But let's come back to that a little bit later. I want to tell you a story. So a long time ago, I joined a company as an agile coach, where basically company was quite big, international, multi-site, and my role was obviously to coach some teams. My manager at that time told me that my evaluation, something that would go to my performance appraisal file, would be the performance of the teams. So basically she told me, if the teams would perform well, you will perform well. If the teams will not perform well, you suck. At that time, I explained to her that it's not possible at all. All of us work in highly complex systems. Now imagine, Luis, come to the company with five other different teams. Some of the team members in one team were extremely upset with the manager, salary problems. They are highly, highly, highly demotivated. Some other team members, remember, one of the team members' mother was dying in the hospital with cancer. Even if we had cross-functional teams, not everyone was reporting to the same person. So it was a cross-functional team, but it was more a matrix team, which means each different person report to a different line manager, which each different line manager belongs to each different department, which each different department has different goals and objectives. And basically, we had QA guys trying to find bugs and developers trying to fix bugs, right? And one was rewarded basically as many bugs as you get, you get more bonus. The other one, as less bugs as you have, you get the bonus, and basically have these guys on the same teams. Now you can see already the nice scenario that I had on my hands. So basically what I mean here is, does not mean just because I'm a good coach or not a good coach, does not mean that I could succeed. I was part of a huge, huge complex system that I could not affect in any way. We all work in system, in complex systems, where we cannot detach ourselves from the system. This is a simple example that I brought to you guys. This is a simple example of the system in our company. Now you guys can tell me that actually you as a manager can differentiate what was the participation, what was the performance of your person, of your team within that system, and what was actually the influence of the system around. It's impossible, right? It's so complex that you cannot distinguish nothing at all. And Tom and Marion, on their book, they even go further. They defend actually that there are only 2% of people that they have a really, really poor performance, and there are only 2% that have an outstanding performance. 96% of the people are in this area, where actually is the system who drives all their performance. Like Peter Zeng said, the guy from the fifth discipline, take the person out from the system and put another person there, and she will perform more or less exactly the same way, because the system is the one who is driving all the behavior. So let's stop. Let's really, really stop thinking that we as managers, or we as people, we as a company, we can easily detach individual performance from the system. There is no way we can do that. There is no way. Another way, or another problem with performance appraisals, is the fact that they are usually used as a rating system, right? So it's from 0 to 5, and 0 is really bad, 5 is really good, and then the manager needs to come up with some kind of grade. But there is a huge problem with that, because it's not a good performance appraisal. It's really bad as a rating system. Why? Simple. Because there is one problem called categorization, which means that we always tend to associate some kind of general people to some people. You know that. So basically, there are more shy people, there are more introverted people. We always I'm a super outgoing guy. Portuguese, I always like to go out with a really lot of people who communicates a lot. I don't connect so well with people that are so shy, because I need always to pull them a bit. So of course, I'm always in favor of people that are more outgoing. And of course, there are always people, a bit on the continuation, there are always people that we always like a bit more, which is the favoritism person, right? If you are a manager, you have a bunch of people working for you, really nice people, but there is always someone special, one that you really like more. And gender, race, and age. This is something really serious. For example, in Germany, where I'm living now, even if the society is trying to fight more and more and more, if you are a woman, you are discriminated. You don't have any chance. People that do the same job, if you are a woman instead of being a guy, immediately get 10 to 15% less money than the normal guy. So if you basically have a lady on your team in Germany, the guy does the same stuff or even less than the lady. The lady performs much better than the guys. She will always be underpaid comparison with the guys. The small village where I was living before I moved to Munich, They even do something really more drastic. They actually force the ladies on the age of 20 to 30s to get a paper from the doctor saying they will not get pregnant in the next 5 years. So please, keep in mind, these always happen because we are human. We cannot avoid this. This is what distinguishes us from animals. There is no other way. We all have feelings. We always have people that we like more than others. So forget it. Performance appraisals will never be fair and will never be great to evaluate your performance. But this was just on the general level. Now I want to explain you how actually now it's bad for our companies actually. So one of the big reasons why performance appraisals exist, to establish goals and targets. So everyone says, or at least people tend to say, we need performance appraisals to set goals, and when we set goals, we will help the company to improve. This is completely nonsense. If you want to improve the company, you cannot improve the individual parts. You need to improve the company as a whole. And now I have a nice story for you. Some years ago, I met a nice Swedish guy that he started the XP on the 98 or 99. So he was working in the software company where basically they were just doing services. So basically the company was getting contracts from the customers and they were delivering software to the customers. And they realized that they were delivering a lot of bugs to the customers. So they decided to start to do XP, because at that time they decided, okay, this is sounds good, let's try. So they did that, they decided to start XP, and the quality of the product went through the roof. Was really, really awesome. No more bugs. Everything was fantastic. Customer satisfaction never ever so high. Then the financial results came. For the first time in history, the guys got lost. They lost money. And they started to investigate. Why? Why? Simple, because they were a service company and they were charging for bugs fixing. As soon as the quality went up, they started to lose money. And this is a small example for you guys to see. Improving the individual parts of the system does not improve the system as a whole. Sometimes it can actually damage the system. If you want to improve it as a whole. Another problem with this approach, attaching money and so on to goals, especially when you attach the money. When you don't attach money to the performances, okay, to the goals. One really good thing that it always happens and people don't even realize. When you have your money attached to your goal, one thing you will do for sure, you will cheat. That's for sure. In my story, for example, when I had this task of coaching, the lady was asking me always to do a small survey every 2 weeks to see where the quality of the team was going, all the different areas. So I had a survey that I need to fill out. And of course, she was looking to the surveys every 2 weeks to see if the company it was getting better, if the teams was getting better. And because my performance was attached to that, I guarantee you, every single week, the performance was going up. Of course, they never went up really well because I was focused more on saving my ass than actually helping people. But this is what happens. And another problem is goals, when you have goals attached to your bonus. What happens? So if you have a goal that is attached to your money, for sure that you will do anything on the safe side. So you don't want to experiment new things. You don't want to try new things because you want to go on the safe path to get your money. That will kill innovation in our companies because people will start not innovating. People will start just taking the safe path in order to get the money. Feedback. This is one of the things that I believe a bit it's useful to give feedback. But let's face it, performance appraisal happens every 6 months. It's extremely useful to have feedback of something that we did 6 months ago. It's really, 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 really awesome. I had a colleague of mine when I left to Riga. She had a performance appraisal of something that happened 6 months ago. Actually, the organization went through some changes and now all the department where she was working does not exist anymore. But still, she went through a performance appraisal session to receive feedback about what she did something. And what about what she did bad and what she did good on something that does not exist anymore? It will help a lot for the future, I guarantee you. Compensation. People always say that we need to have performance appraisal sessions to get compensation problem solved. This is nonsense. As I showed on some slides ago, 96% of the people are within the system. You cannot separate them. So it's nonsense whatsoever trying to measure how good you are or bad you are if any other person would behave exactly in the same way because the system drives the behavior. So this is something that really does not make any sense. You can just simply find a form like many of other companies are doing to decide where you are, where we want to be on your society, if you want to pay higher, if you want to pay less, and then design some nice formulas, like for example, Jürgen Appel is trying to do now with the salary formulas and so on. This is much better approach. Forget performance appraisals sessions to define salaries. Coaching and guidance. This is something that everyone now talks. A manager needs to be a coach. But let's face it, I'm a coach. My official title is coach. And I can tell you, I don't know anything about coaching. I'm investing a lot of time, a lot of money in getting professional courses, professional trainings, and I still believe that I don't know anything about coaching. Now I ask you, how many of you managers, how many of you that have managers receive actually any coaching training? I'm pretty sure that there are not so many people that actually know how to do proper coaching. That's the first problem. Second problem, people still believe that the manager and the person that's it's rating you, judging you, it's like God. He owns everything and he should be the one coaching you for everything. But this is not true. You have different skills and you need different skills on your daily work. You don't need just your boss to coach. Of course, your boss can be a great guy to coach you. But just the boss, it's nonsense. You need some other people, especially in agile companies now, agile teams. Come on, we have testing, we have QA, we have business analysts, we have everything, so many different things that people are specialists. You need to be coached by everyone, not just by one simple person. Personal development, that's another one that companies really like to put some nice grades to see how did you behave in the past, and how it's a signal how you will behave in the future. Nonsense. Most of you, I believe, like I was a developer. Great, great architects, great developers, they do not want to be in the management positions. Sometimes they need to go to the management position if they want to get a better, comfortable life, because it's where the money is most of the times, is on the management position. Not all the companies offer a technical track. So sometimes we lose fantastic architects to get really crappy project managers, for example. Right? This is true, and everyone knows it, right? So just because you perform as a fantastic project manager, architect, does not mean that you'll be a fantastic project manager. This is nonsense. So it's better to get rid of this, and actually what a lot of companies are doing is they are not caring anymore with the records. Of course, they can take a look at it, but when they need a specific person, they do a normal interview, like they always do if it would be for some external position, because each different position requires a different type of person. Legal documentation. Everyone needs to have a paper in case we want to fire someone. Actually, in reality, there are a lot of studies on the books that I can present on the end of the presentation, where it shows that companies are losing much more money keeping the records than actually if they would throw them away. Because what happens is, when someone has a problem with the company, or when the company triggers a problem with someone, when they go to court, usually the first years everything is going well. And then only when there is a problem with the manager, then the situation goes on court. So usually, actually, the courts don't care anymore with this kind of papers, because for so many months and years in the company, the guy had a performance, fantastic performance. So why the hell now the problem is with the person after so many years of good performance? So this is a small summary that I did for you. I'll put it like for 5 seconds, 10 seconds, just for you. How actually we have on the left side, on your left side, agile thinking and actually what performance appraisals are doing to our society and to our companies. So I leave it for 5 seconds. Someone's taking pictures, it's okay. So this is taken from the book Abolish Performance Appraisals from Tom and Mary. Okay, so this guy, I think you know, all of them, summarize already what performance appraisal are. So basically they start making you thinking in short-term performance. They destroy your long-term planning, so basically companies go just on firefighting. They build fear within company. Demolish teamwork, rivalry. So what to do then? Where to go? So I had a discussion last week with John Sandon. I don't know if you know, it's a guy, really popular guy, who wrote a book called Freedom from Command and Control and I Want You to Cheat. So those two really popular books. And because I'm now trying to get big people to help me how to find new solutions. And basically the guy said, it's not about what to do instead. It's really basically get rid of it. So this is something that there are too many bad things ongoing, so we just need to get rid of it and we need to learn how to work without it. So what to do? Well, there is no magic formula. There is no magic recipe. Like you know, guys, some stuff that works in one company might not work in another company. Context is everything, right? Sometimes we try to copy some things that we learn with one team to other team, and most of the times that does not work because the scenario is different, people are different. So we always need to try out new things. But from my research and for what I'm trying to do in my company with the director of HR, there are three levels. On the organizational part, the first thing you need to do is just drop this old rating system. This destroys people. You cannot, like I explained already, you cannot rate people. You cannot compare people. Just simply drop it. Does not mean that you forget the people. Of course, no. We can choose different ways to still have people. There was several companies that I was studying. They have Excel files. Instead of going to HR, they are kept by the manager and the employee in order to get discussions ongoing. But it's some simple mechanism that they can freely choose how to select them, how to use them, and so on. And make goals visible. So there was a study, interesting one. There is a police department in the US where basically they put the goals from the department all over the place. They spread the goals on the walls, everywhere. Everyone knows what the goals of the police department is for that year, that semester. And actually, each person then goes and puts the name under the goal that he wants to work on. So that is the way how they actually do it. On the leadership part, you need to be really, really strong. You need to create a clear vision of purpose. You need to clear the mission of your company, what you want, the goals that you want to achieve, and continuously repeat and repeat and repeat. I remember once I said to one of my ex-companies, top management, that I told them, people are lost. We don't know where to go. There is no technical view that people want to follow. And his answer was, because you lost you were not here, you were on holidays when we communicate that on the meeting. So as you can see, basically, a lot of people, they have the vision or they have the strategy, but they simply think that just communicating one simple meeting is enough. It's not enough. You need to repeat it, repeat it, repeat it, repeat it. You need to make it unforgettable for the people so that people, when they come back to work, they know what they are talking about and they know what they need to do. You need to having continuous feedback culture. And this is super, super, super easy on the team level in Agile, for example. We have so many mechanisms of feedback. We have Agile retrospectives. We have information radiators. You have feedback walls. You have so many things that we now need to start to scale to all the organization in order to get feedback in all different levels of the organization, not just on the team level. Continuous education. People need to still continue to educate themselves. And this leads me to the third one, where companies need to invest a lot of money, especially in system thinking, for example, because otherwise they would never understand the graphic that I showed you, that where I showed that 96% of the people are part of the system. They will never understand this. It will be a super complex concept for them. We need feedback mechanisms, like I explained, PDCA tools, communication, training on motivation. This is super, super, super important. Managers need to understand how actually people get motivated, how actually people find ways to come to work and be happy, and how to provide and promote great work. So guys, now I would like to help me to create a movement where actually we help companies to create environments where people are happy and they are really eager to go to work, where they can find their purpose, their mastery, and their autonomy, where they are not treated as another puppet. And for that, I'm writing this book where you guys can contribute being a beta reader. Right now there is almost 500 people already on that loop, where I'm writing every month or every 2 weeks a chapter, where I send to everyone, to the population, to the mailing list, get the feedback, incorporate the feedback on the book, and continue going. So if you want to participate, feel free. And this was what I have for you today. Thank you very much.